Hi, I'm Harjit Dalwal, and I'm in London, England to sit down with some folks from the London Stock Exchange Group to talk about their recent experiences with Windows 365, Copilot, WSL, GitHub Copilot, and much, much more. Let's hear how they did this with great user satisfaction with high security standards. Let's go. Hello and welcome, Rehan and Jacques. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Glad to be here.
So let's let everyone know who you are, what you do at London Stock Exchange Group, or LSEG.
Thank you. Rehan, I am the Intune Administrator. I'm the lead engineer at London Stock Exchange Group.
Jacques, and I'm the head of digital work strategy. It's a mouthful for me, and effectiveness. So I focus on people productivity.
So you're the strategist.
Yes.
And you're the deployment, management, and architect.
Implementation. Yes, yeah.
So it's a good mix of folks here. So let's start with, we know you, London Stock Exchange, or LSEG, has been doing Windows 365 very effectively, loving it. Why?
When I joined, I came through an acquisition at, I came from the, what they call Thomson Reuters, a definitive part of the side of the family. When I came in, Rehan was already working on a fantastic setup for the laptop. No, and I wish I could take credit for it, but no, it's all he's doing. And he had done something fantastic around the laptop, the way it's managed, streamlining all this, you know, the configuration, making sure that this laptop experience was top notch. And it worked because people told us this is the best, you know, laptop I've used in any of my experience, right? In the banks before. So we thought about how do we reproduce that same experience that people have on the laptop on a virtual device. And that time, Microsoft was coming out with something that was like this new way of doing virtual. There was a new paradigm around licensing and all these things. So that was intriguing. So we started looking at it.
So if things were working with a physical environment, but what was the main purpose of moving to Windows 365?
One of the important factors is, as Jack says, we already had a build in terms of Intune, in terms of configuration, baseline policies, and so on. So we've got a fully approved London Stock Exchange type of build that we are happy with and our cybersecurity people are happy with. So we need to ensure an end user compute experience as well as the cybersecurity requirement is met. What we then decided to do was around Windows 365 is what is the time to market? What's the cost to market? And it was the minimum in terms of how much we need to work on, how many configurations we need to apply. It's like it's already there. We didn't need to redesign, and that's why I think Windows 365 was the best for us. Wouldn't you agree, Jack?
Yep. Yeah. Maybe your question, Arjit, was about why not give everybody a laptop, right? Because we are, let's remember, we are a laptop first organization.
Exactly.
Because we believe that, you know, having the hardware as close from your finger and from your brain is going to be what enables the best productivity or if you're on a train. However, we cannot give a laptop to everybody. We have partners that have to use their own laptop.
Right.
We have contractors and, but even some people who are using a non-Windows device may need from time to time to use a Windows device, because there are some applications that only run. So in this case, we need a very good solution that is rock solid and stable and that we can deploy close to the user. One of the things that we designed originally was, you know, in a typical design for a virtual device, you select, you know, maybe three locations, you know, typically New York, you know, somewhere in Europe or London and somewhere in Asia. What about all these people who are in between? The reason you limit yourself to the number of place where you deployed it, first of all, because it's difficult to deploy. And the second is because you need networking, you know, you need virtual network
Absolutely.
To connect back. And with Rehan, we really decided stop that. I want to be able, if somebody is in, you know, in South India and Microsoft has a center close, and they do, I want to be able to provision that device without this extra cost of managing it. Yeah. And also without this complexity of adding a network. Because you have to realize, you know, when you are in a heavily regulated environment, every change is quite complex and require a lot of energy and effort. Yep. So Rayan came back with this solution of using the 365 out of the box, right?
Yeah, in fact, we're using existing configuration. So out of the box, 365 essentially just worked for us.
You just shifted it
exactly.
over to you.
Right. There are certain policies, for example, timeouts and so on mm-hmm. that we need to think about. But for us, it was just really easy to, I wouldn't say easy in terms of implementing it and putting it into the organization, but from a technical perspective, it was already there, already designed. And as Jack said, we could have it in any region we wanted,
exactly.
and it's close to all of our end users.
Right. So one of the things I'm hearing is, I've heard speaking with your colleagues and stuff, is the developer environment. So this was very key to that organization, right?
Absolutely.
To support your developers so that they can do good work from anywhere, things like that. Yeah. You guys want to expand into that?
Yeah, so our developer requirements were not to use multiple devices, to have Windows with production access, so your emails, your Teams, and so on,
mm-hmm.
but also have access to Linux because we are very heavily Linux users. How do we do that? So the best way is WSL, Windows Subsystem for
exactly.
Linux.
Exactly, yeah. And that's something you are using very heavily here,
exactly.
right?
Exactly,
yes.
exactly.
But before we go there, I think it's important to just to go back of where we were before.
Yeah.
In the past, a developer had, you know, their corporate network, their desktop, right? Where they do their email, their Teams, their, you know, all their meetings. And they would have a secondary device where they do all their development work. First of all, it's cumbersome, and I think it also negates the way people work today.
Mm-hmm.
If you think about, you know, the same way as a corporate user, you need to be connected. As a developer, you need even to be even more connected to your product manager, sometimes to your customers,
yes.
sometimes to your QA team, mm-hmm. and all these things. So having the idea that, okay, I'm going to do this here, and I'm going to do this here, and there is a wall in between, think about the productivity that
productivity impact
that you are introducing
right.
here.
Right. Yeah. So what were the challenges that you faced when you were putting all of this together for your developers and Windows 365, and how did you circumvent that?
The cyber policies and cyber requirements was one of our biggest ones.
Sure.
But understandably so, we're a heavily regulated environment. Things like making sure we know exactly who's using what, mm-hmm. exactly how many people have a Linux device. And one of the routes that we didn't go down is a Linux image that's managed. Because I don't think we're or the product is in a mature place at the moment to fully manage a Linux device. And that's why we went down the WSL route. As I was speaking to Craig earlier around whether we're using bare metal, whether we're using VMware and so on, we couldn't manage Linux devices within Tune. So WSL was the best place to do it. We have an offline Ubuntu image that we've built around our cyber policies, so with all our cyber tools in place, and we've managed to package it up for an LSEG end user. So not necessarily out of the box, but an LSEG end user package using our existing methodologies, our packaging team, our deployment team, how you request the image, how you request WSL, and how it's switched on a user's device. I think the challenge with having all of that in place mm-hmm. is if a user has got WSL, what are they doing with it? What commands are they running? Is it something that is useful to the organization? Is it something that they shouldn't be running? Is recording all of that? And one of the things that we had difficulty was around compliance. Do you have an image that isn't an LSEG image? Have you downloaded a Red Hat or something like that? Doing your own work that you shouldn't be doing. How do we monitor it? How do we stop users from doing it? Those are the challenges that we've faced.
So how did you work with those challenges and who helped you with that?
So that's, I think, and that's this tension, right, between I want a completely open system where I can do whatever I want.
Yes.
On the other end, I want a system which is completely secure, where I can actually, the most secure system is somewhere when you cannot log in, right? Mm-hmm. So that's going to be secure. And how do you figure out where to put the balance? And I think it's a partnership between the development community, the engineering community with Rayanne here, and cyber and the security. Mm-hmm. And, you know, because these three groups, sometimes we couldn't find the solution. So we reached out to Microsoft. And it was really amazing because we got a much more answer than we expected. And we had Craig, you know, Lewin, we really jump in. And I must admit, we were surprised by the level of engagement we got from Microsoft.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, it was really, you know, I was not expecting it. And that was a virtuous circle, because the more you do it, the more you work with him, the more he understands the needs of his customers. Mm-hmm. And we were able to work with him to sometimes accelerate the delivery of some features because they were so important to us in our packaging, right?
So the Microsoft partnership has been very positive.
Oh, yes.
And I've been told, I've had conversations here, you know, in LSEG, and, I'm hearing that if you would have done this work on your own, it would have taken you probably about 2 years.
Yes.
But with the, you know, strong partnership and willingness to meet you guys with what you need and configure, you know, the toolings and the extensions and things like that you need that is so unique to your environment, and they came through, right?
We started
in 6 months, probably.
Yeah, we started, I remember, very early in January, in earnest in February. So yeah, not even, you know, a little bit over 6 months. And it's not over, right? We still have a lot to deliver to our users.
Sure.
And the great news is we can see that there are strong foundation, you know, in WSL2 and Win365. Good example. The kernel that you run on WSL2 is a Linux kernel, the same that you run on Azure in your Linux boxes. So think about it. That means that when our developers are testing that on their machines, they are pretty high level of compatibility with the Azure environment. So that was a really interesting discovery.
So your developers who are using WSL are able to do all the native functionalities and coding and stuff like that you would have in Linux itself.
Exactly.
Right?
That's the idea. And it's developing as well. Mm-hmm. There are features that still can be improved. And I think that collaboration and the challenges that we face, I think, is very important, because without those challenges, we wouldn't have had those conversations and the features that have been implemented.
Absolutely. And you wouldn't have the learnings, right?
Exactly.
What about code development and stuff? Copilot, GitHub Copilot.
Let me tell you something. I was a developer once, a long time ago. And, you know, I was a C. I started with assembly language. That tells you a little bit about the. And I believe I was a great developer, but some people have different opinion on that. But now I'm writing, you know, in Python, for example. In the past, you know, 2 or 3 years ago, how would you start coding in a language you didn't really know, like the back of your hand, right? You will go to Google, you will search for it, you will find code, you will copy paste. That's completely gone. Now you ask him, please, like the other day, I was asking, I needed to process some netstat output. And I said, please, write the command to process netstat output. And he created, he forked the process, run netstat process. He said, no, you don't understand. I want you to process a text file. There's a content, it changed, open the file, process it. And I said, okay, now, grab the data and organize it as a table.
And you just keep adding
and
more.
And you keep
and
adding
more and more.
The productivity you have there.
It's now, amazing.
It is, because I don't have years of experience in Python. But it also, and sometimes it's almost scary. I was telling my wife, I think these things is watching me, because, you know, as you are typing, it starts proposing changes.
Exactly.
So, I think we are rolling it out. And there are for beginner, actually, it's you have some level of value, but for you know, old timer like me, I think it's invaluable.
Yeah, so as a former sysadmin myself, I lived in PowerShell.
Yep.
Right? PowerShell was the thing. It still is.
Yes.
You know, everybody, hey, I need to do something. PowerShell it is, PowerShell yep. that, and scripts and stuff. And you have to know it. You have to learn it, right? It's a big learning curve for it. It's not easy. But Copilot makes it so much simpler. Now I have, you know, IT pros that tell me, they'll just put something into Copilot and they'll tell them, they'll spit out a script. You still need to verify it, right? Make sure that it's working, test it and all that stuff. But it gives you the gist of it and, you know, what exactly it's doing. So it's phenomenal.
Like you, I mean, I'm very, from a sysadmin perspective, very heavy PowerShell user. Mm-hmm. Initially, I was skeptical because I like looking at my own work. I like coding my own stuff and knowing what I've done. And you think, if I'm getting AI to write it, mm-hmm. I don't know what's been written without actually going through every single line of code. But I'm a convert, and I think it helps so much. Whereas before, you could spend days writing a piece of code. You can do it in hours now, even less.
You know, this kind of reminds me of, you know, back in the day, when people used to build websites and they used to do HTML, right? And then you came, you know, there were tools like GUI tools, right? That you just, hey, I want to do this and put this image here and stuff like that. But it's doing HTML in the background, right?
Yeah.
This is the same situation right now where we are. So it's
the challenge you're going to get is the expectation is going to grow.
Yeah, yeah.
If it's so easy to code now, they will want more.
Be sure to catch part two of our conversation with Jacques and Rehan from LSEG, where we continue the discussion on Windows 365, Copilot, and much more.
Thank you for watching Tackling Tech. I hope you enjoyed this episode and learned something new. Stay tuned for future episodes. Like and subscribe. See you next time.